appears there's another opportunity. The Stirling Castle is coming out of the sands.
We've actually got two of the more important people of the 79. One of the lead divers is John Chamberlain, that young chap.
The old faces are at a press launch for a new survey attempt, but there's a new team gathered. They're using better technology, filming with digital cameras. And they've a new motto, cameras for crowbars.
We were a crowbar people, but now cameras are moving into a price that even the average diver can look forward to having. And we think that method of bringing back information as against an item, so that's what we say is, you know, not quite a sort of an amnesty of give us your crowbar and we'll give you a camera, but get that as a philosophy.
The Department of Culture's Archaeological Dive Unit, which inspects wrecks, is there. It's led by Martin Dean, so amazed by the Stirling back in the 70s. He's giving up as much of his time as possible to support them. But they're on a very tight schedule, sometimes with years between visits to wrecks. The team have found a rare artifact, a log reel from which a knotted line streamed off the stern would have measured speed with the aid of a sand timer. It's a valuable addition to the navigation kit.
We allocated up to 3 weeks on this particular project. We've been here almost 3 weeks. One of those weeks was virtually wiped out with bad weather, but we've managed to get some work done, and we have to move on to other tasks, unfortunately.
50 seconds.
But this is where we have to rely on the locals to continue.
It's 1 minute, you are clear to surface. Roger, on the surface.
The local team have been joined by some Americans. Their first task is to clear fishing nets, which have caught on the wreck. They're a major source of damage. These amateur divers have been trained by the Nautical Archaeological Society, funded by heritage grants. They're led by Bob Peacock.
On a daily basis, it depends between 10, 15 people. Some days we've had 30 people. Each people put their time as and when they can. Some people have taken holidays, some people are just doing it on their days off and working with their work schedule, their normal day, you know, day-to-day job, because we're all unpaid. People's not being paid for this, so I've taken 2 weeks holiday, the American team have taken 2 weeks holiday.
Tell you what, it doesn't get much darker than that down there.
In very difficult conditions, valuable work is being done.
It is some sort of metal. I haven't actually...
However, to expert observers, there needs to be much more support, with time so short and the stakes so high.
I don't really seem to place it on anything that I've seen before.
What should have happened over the summer to the Stirling Castle is exactly resources should have been made available for an objective record of the site. I know they are trying to do it themselves, but it would be much more efficiently done, I think, by probably using remote vehicles, remote equipment. It could be done faster than doing it by divers. It needs to be done fast. It needs to be completely objective, acquiring the data again so we can really see what's happening. There is advice, of course, from the ADU, from the Archaeological Diving Unit, but there are no resources, there is no technology to put in and back them up.
For the local team, it's a case of just getting on with it without going cap in hand. That, at least, hasn't changed in 20 years.
There is only so many resources to go around, and it's not for me to say where that money is spent. I subsidise this project because it's on my patch. Other people subsidise their project because it's on their patch. But yes, it would be nice if there was a government body of monies and a team to go around, but at the moment there isn't. So I don't make policies, I just comply with my licence. If you sat down and said, well, it's going to cost X amount of money for this, you say, no, I'd put that resource to other things. Maybe a holiday. I mean, this is my holiday this year.
As the season progresses, there's growing concern that this opportunity may be passing by.
If the sand continues to retreat from around the wreck, it will become more and more vulnerable to natural depredation. It's already suffering from marine organisms, but colonising the wreck and slowly disintegrating the wood, the outside parts. But violent winter storms could easily collapse the whole structure into a pile of matchwood, and then once the thing breaks up, the items will disappear in the tide because there are very strong currents out there, and they'd be swept away.
For those who believe this is another missed opportunity, there's an added frustration that the shortcomings of maritime protection have been acknowledged regularly in government documents over the years. An Under Secretary of State wrote in 1974, "We know the Protection of Wrecks Act has its limitations and is only interim protection. We hope to put forward proposals for legislation next year." That should have been in 1975. And Margaret Rule recalls other pledges.
We were promised that it would be reviewed in 8 or 10 years' time, and that review has never really happened. We're told in parliamentary replies that it's working satisfactorily.
The government proposed giving marine archaeology to English Heritage in 1996. It was discussed again recently, but the Department of Culture say while keen to see underwater archaeology sites treated as well as land sites, they're waiting for a suitable legislative opportunity. Critics have heard that for a quarter of a century with no action, while two opportunities to survey the Stirling have passed.
Second time round, I think I'm ashamed to be an English archaeologist. I cannot believe that we didn't get our act together sufficiently to support the volunteer divers who were there the second time round doing their very best without the best in technological support and a big team to really get the best information out of this window, this rare opportunity to see this magnificently preserved vessel for another time.
The patience of licensees is running out. Some are threatening to break away and form their own organisation. For many people, it's the Goodwin Sands that encapsulate the untapped potential of maritime heritage. Each year, when the sands appear at especially low tides, visitors make a pilgrimage to this eerie island.
Hard to believe when you look at these featureless sands with not a shell, not a piece of wreckage, nothing, that beneath our feet are hundreds and hundreds of shipwrecks. Here in the UK, we've got the most important shipwreck site in the world. I don't think any world archaeologist would disagree. Sitting on our doorstep, as it were, where throughout history, thousands if not millions of ships have passed. And it's a death trap for ships. Anything that lands on it sinks. It gets caught in the sand, which is fluid when it's wet, and it slowly sinks.
We have to consider this making it a National Heritage Park. We're not talking about the whole of the Goodwins. We're talking perhaps 4 square miles. The only thing I'm trying to protect it is from rogue divers. Also, if it was a national park, we could have an input of money into it to research the wrecks that are being found out there. We could find more wrecks. We could get a proper team together that would both police it and dive it, perhaps the whole summer long.
Stirling Castle. The log reel, a significant find, was going to be raised and conserved, but it was destroyed by the strong currents. For other exposed artefacts, it's a bad omen, with the risk of more winter storms ahead. The treasure trove for historians is immense, but getting close to the human story within a major event is perhaps the real prize. Being able to revisit a single night when a maritime nation reaching the height of its powers was rocked by a natural catastrophe.
Rear Admiral Beaumont, whose flag was flying in the Mary, perished among the rest.
Of more than 1,000 souls lost in this calamity, only one has left any abiding image. Admiral Beaumont, 34 years old. But the wreck artifacts can bring others to life. David Perkins was cleaning a delicate candlestick from the Stirling Castle.
I suddenly realised that the object trapped was the finger of somebody's right hand. And that's what brought it home to me, that while we've been dealing for 6 months or to a year with a mass of very interesting objects, They weren't just something, a time capsule that had been bequeathed to us in terms of just a museum exhibition. They were intimately tied in with a great catastrophic event, something that must have affected thousands of people, not just the people that drowned, not just the person who probably drowned in a cabin in darkness, holding a candle as the water levels rose and he was trapped in there forever as far as he was concerned, but for the widows ashore, the orphan children, the dependents. It must have been an awful thing that had an impact for a whole generation.
Of 160 sail that were in the Downs the previous day, not more than 70 were seen the next morning. Josiah Burchett, Secretary to the Admiralty.
The Department of Culture have told us that wreck licensees are free to apply for Heritage Fund grants. To our knowledge, no licensees have been given money.